me turn it over to Lee Smolin.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for staying for the last talk. I'm very grateful to the Rotman Institute and to Chris and everybody here for the invitation, the opportunity to speak. I certainly have gotten enormous simulation and stimulation, well, just stimulation from interaction with philosophers for many years. Yesterday, Simon raised the question of has philosophy of science really done anything for physics, for fundamental physics? And just speaking for the field of fundamental quantum gravity, I think that there were very important inputs from philosophy, from inspiration from philosophy throughout. And we can argue whether John Stachel or Julian Barber are philosophers or physicists or people on the boundary, whatever. But had they not made their contributions about the importance of the whole argument, about relationalism, about diffeomorphism and variance, what we call background independence, I think the whole development of non-perturbative quantum gravity would have not occurred, or certainly not have occurred as robustly. So let's hear it for the interaction of philosophy and physics. Now, this, I know that I often am on the edge, and I often give talks with speculation, but this is the real thing. I'm terrified. So, and this is the first time I give this talk, so we'll see how it goes. The outline, I have 7 things to do in 60 minutes, so it'll be fast. And I think because of that, I won't read the outline to you, but it's been up there in case anybody read it. Now, I think it's important to say, in spite of a lot of progress and genuine progress, understanding different proposals for quantum gravity, that we do not have a, let alone the, quantum theory of gravity. We have what I think are best called models: string theory, loop quantum gravity, spin foams, causal dynamical triangulations, causal sets, quantum gravity, and a host of others are models of plausible quantum gravitational physics. They each have achievements within a domain, and they each have issues transcending that domain and being a general theory. And there are 2 reasons I think we should keep in mind why we don't yet have a theory. One of them is that, as Einstein recommended and taught us, really fundamental theories are principal theories, are based on positing fundamental principles. And we don't know the theories of quantum gravity. We don't know the principles for quantum gravity. The theories that we have that I mentioned are more like constituent theories. They're hypotheses about what lives in quantum spacetime, what the geometry of quantum spacetime is like. So we don't yet have a quantum theory of gravity. But of course, we have to. There must be something out there. We want to make one. The other reason is that a theory should not only explain the physics that we know, it should predict something novel, and that something should be testable without getting to the ins and outs of falsification and Popper and Popperizzi and so forth. We want new knowledge and we want testable knowledge, and we should never give up that aspiration, and I'll have some proposals for that. So I'm proposing, at least to myself, I would not tell other people what to do, but for my own work, I've been thinking in terms of a different kind of strategy for quantum gravity that starts with principles. And I'm going to show you some candidate principles, and much of the talk will be about the right formulation of one of those principles. From the principles, we should recover what we know, i.e. general relativity, whether it's emergent, etc., we should recover it. We should derive experimental tests when we can directly from principles, as Einstein used the equivalence principle so adroitly to talk about the bending of light, the slowing down of clocks and gravitational fields and so forth. something that I'm more and more interested in, and that this talk is an example of, is we have, I think, a very tired, overworked little domain of possible quantum gravity physics, and we should be more imaginative. If the quantum theory of gravity really is the theory that brings together what we know, we should look for new domains of quantum gravitational phenomena, new domains in which we might test the theory. And again, that's primarily what this talk is a proposal of a new domain. And we should then employ models to connect principles to phenomenon. That's what models are for. And I think of general relativity not as a fundamental theory, but as a model which instantiates principles like let's just call it background independence, or the identity of the indiscernible, the equivalence principle. Okay, so this is my proposal for a strategy, at least for my own work. And that's what we're going to be focusing on today, is looking for new regimes of quantum gravity phenomenon. So I wrote a paper over the last several years. It was posted last November, in which I proposed four principles. And I'm disappointed that there's more than two, because two is a good number. But and it's been done before. But it seems to me like there is a need for four independent principles of quantum gravity. They're very much a work in progress. But they're some first principle to say what the theory is about. And my proposal, which not everybody agrees with, is that the theory of space-time, of gravity, classically and quantum mechanically, is about two things. It's about causation and causal structure, and it's about the flow of dynamical quantities like energy and momentum in that causal structure. So I call this the principle of absolute causality and relative locality. Then, as Karen described yesterday very well, there needs to be a correspondence principle, as in the old quantum theory, to tell us how the physics of the new theory connects to the physics of the old theory, i.e. general relativity. Then there's been, for many years since Itauch first proposed it, an idea that there's a principle called the holographic principle. And I don't think we understand it. I don't think we have the right version for quantum gravity, but that there should be some version of the holographic principle. And finally, some version of the equivalence principle should extend to quantum mechanics and quantum space-time. So those are the four principles that, for me, are a work in progress. Now, there, in that paper, I fill them in. I'm not going to go through all of them, but just to say that there is a proposal for each of them in progress on the table in that paper. They together suffice, and this is the work of that paper, to reproduce the Einstein equations. And the methodology for the emergence of the Einstein equations is through Ted Jacobson's idea that the equations of general relativity, the Einstein equations, are thermodynamic equations, equations of state, of some more fundamental quantum space-time dynamics. And I think that that's a way for classical Einstein equations to emerge, which I think is highly recommended over other ideas about how classical space-time could emerge. But again, that's not the subject of this talk. This is just all to give you a background. The subject of this talk is the fate of the equivalence principle. Here's a version of it. For quantum physics, the observer, we consider various classes of observers in a quantum space-time. In the absence of curvature and the absence of a cosmological constant. And what's tricky about formulating the equivalence principle in this context is that there's the vacuum of quantum field theory around, and that is a highly non-local physical object. And that non-locality, which is implicit in the vacuum, is in strong tension with the locality demanded by the equivalence principle. And that's going to be a theme of this talk, how to resolve that tension. And that's why I start off by saying, in the absence of curvature, in the absence of a cosmological constant, the observers who see the vacuum, a maximally entropic thermal state, are those in the classical limit are uniformly accelerating. That's the first statement of the principle. Hence, those observers who see the vacuum to have zero temperature are coincident with what we used to call inertial observers. So we make a principle out of a coincidence. That is, the way that we usually work up the unruh effect, we demand and put it in, although we could put it in very differently, that there's a coincidence. The observers that see zero temperature in the quantum field theoretic vacuum are the same as the observers that judge themselves to be inertial. And the move I'm making here is that we should turn that coincidence into a principle, very much the way Einstein turned several coincidences into principles. So that's as far as I've got in the paper that I've been referring to. But that is only cogent if the cosmological constant is zero. What happens if we turn on a cosmological constant? What happens to that principle? And that's the question that this talk is addressed to. What is the right form for a quantum extension of the equivalence principle in the presence of a small cosmological constant? And I'm going to deal with the positive case. I think the negative case is really what ADS-CFT is all about. It's about what is the quantum equivalence principle for a small negative cosmological constant. And that's a very interesting subject, which I think is highly misunderstood. For example, some people have the impression it has something to do with string theory. That was supposed to be funny. But we're going to talk here about the positive case, the case of positive cosmological constant. So let's go back to the classical equivalence principle, because I want to emphasize that there are two parts to it. There's the part that says that freely falling observers whose extent is much smaller than the radius of curvature see themselves to zeroth order to be in a domain described by special relativity, i.e. you can go into a freely falling frame and gravity, the effects of gravity disappear to first order in the size of your extent over the radius of curvature. The second part is that uniformly accelerated observers see themselves as if to leading order in the same quantities they're in a uniform gravitational field. I.e. gravity can be mocked up to zeroth order in acceleration or by acceleration. Now, of course, classically, these two statements are equivalent. But there's a tension between them in the quantum case for two reasons. One of them is because of the non-locality of the vacuum of quantum theory, which puts a different challenge to extending each of them. And the second thing is because if particles are massive, they have a Compton wavelength, which provides another length scale, which has to be taken into account when you're considering what limits hold in what order. So I'm going to propose that those two principles, those two parts of the classical equivalence principle, get separated when we go into the quantum mechanical, quantum gravity regime. And that's why I brought this to your attention. Now, together with the assumption that Newtonian physics governs the small velocity limit of the physics seen by freely falling observers, the equivalence principle, as we well know, demands the equivalence of inertial and gravitational mass. Keep your eye on that, because that is a place where we're going to be able to find some flexibility as the talk goes on. I'm going to be looking to relax in a certain way the equivalence of inertial and gravitational mass. So keep your eye on that.
Sorry, you say the last line, you said that Compton wavelength is much less than the radius of curvature, is it?
Yes, we demand that to have a cogent form of the equivalence principle.
And photons have infinite counterexamples.
That's a problem.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now, ever since Unruh and Bekenstein and so forth, there's been another issue about the equivalence principle extending quantum mechanically. Unruh taught us that a uniformly accelerated observer with an acceleration A sees a temperature given by h bar times the acceleration over 2 pi times the speed of light. That smells of the equivalence principle, or some version of the equivalence principle. It makes you want to say that if you are a static observer in a uniform gravitational field, you're also warm. But how to say that is tricky because the Unruh effect is a highly non-local effect. And it's non-local because there's a length scale, L, which is inverse to the acceleration, which is the distance to your horizon. By virtue of being a uniformly accelerated observer, there's a horizon beyond which you can't receive information. The distance to the horizon is also the rough size of the peak wavelength of the thermal distribution that you see. So if you're thinking of accelerations that are small, the thermal radiation that you see has a big wavelength. The wavelength goes inverse to the acceleration. And that's the scale over which the quantum vacuum is disturbed by the presence of the uniformly accelerated detector, or in general, the uniformly accelerated charge. And it goes inverse to what you hope for, i.e., small acceleration is a disturbance over a big space, over a big scale. And that's a big challenge to the kind of locality that you want to capture by the equivalence principle. So we're going to have to resolve that if we're going to have an extension of the equivalence principle to quantum gravity and quantum physics. Now, keep all that in mind, and I want to talk dimensional analysis and orders of magnitude to talk about possible regimes and especially possible new regimes of quantum gravitational phenomena. Let's assume there is some theory T, which is the quantum theory of gravity. It has 4 dimensional constants as far as we know: h bar, Newton's constant, the speed of light, and the cosmological constant. It might have more, for example, the emergency parameter, but it certainly will depend on at least those 4. And the fact that those are overcomplete gives opportunities for inventing and finding new domains of quantum gravity phenomena. That there aren't 3, as we often say, there are really 4. Now, we're very used to thinking that there are limits which reproduce known physics. Take h bar to 0 and you get back general relativity. Take Newton's constant and the cosmological constant to 0 and you get back quantum field theory and galaxy space-time. But there are other limits which are not so often thought about that are opportunities. For example, take h bar to 0 and Newton's constant to 0. You think you get rid of gravity, you get rid of quantum mechanics, but do it in such a way that you hold the Planck energy or the Planck mass fixed. I'm also holding the speed of light fixed. That defines a domain of quantum gravitational phenomenon which is non-quantum and non-gravitational, but still has a scale having to do with quantum gravity, which is the Planck energy. There's no Planck length, there's no Planck energy, so there's no quantum geometry. But there's quantum gravitational physics, because the Planck mass is a scale. And there's actually an experimental domain which investigates this limit, and it used to be called deformed or doubly special relativity. It's now called relative locality. And there's a whole literature about this domain. It's not the subject of my talk, but it should prod and inspire our imaginations to look for other domains. And let's note that we can have a domain of quantum gravitational phenomenon even at h bar equals zero, if we think imaginatively enough. Another domain for negative cosmological constant is the case of small cosmological constants. So the ratio of the Planck area to the cosmological scale, r squared, is small. And that's the limit that the ADS-CFT phenomenology studies. And again, there's a huge literature about that from which we have a lot to learn. Or there's the domain where we take the Planck energy to infinity or maybe to zero, keeping the Planck area fixed. And I hate to say it, but that's the domain that 90% of loop quantum gravity is investigating. If you don't couple to matter, you don't have a separate way to scale G and H bar. So you only get one constant from G and H bar, which is the Planck area. You only get quantum geometry. Because you don't get quantum dynamics, because you don't have the Planck mass or the Planck energy. And I think a lot of the work in loop quantum gravity and other approaches to quantum gravity that don't bring in matter explicitly are stuck in that corner. You give tremendous insight as to that corner, but that's a subdomain of the full physics. I think we don't always emphasize that. Now, just to remind you, I'm interested in the case of small positive cosmological constant where I'm going to look for a new domain. So let me remind you that there's a length scale, R, which is the radius of curvature of de Sitter space. There is an acceleration, which is the acceleration of the universe. It's what people talk about when they say the universe is accelerating due to a cosmological constant. And analogous to the Unruh temperature, there's a temperature, which is the temperature of the cosmological horizon in de Sitter spacetime, the so-called de Sitter temperature, which is the same form as the Unruh temperature with the cosmological acceleration. So let me now think that we know the quantum theory of gravity. We have a small cosmological constant, which is positive. And let's think about the domain of phenomenon where all the length scales are large compared to the distance to the cosmological horizon. And all accelerations are small compared to the acceleration of the universe. And energies and temperatures are small compared to the ambient temperature of the de Sitter horizon. That's a domain of physics. I want to focus on that domain of physics. And to emphasize that it might be accessible, let me sit in that domain of physics. It's the far infrared domain of quantum gravity, but with a cosmological constant. And then take a limit, throw away explicit quantum effects, H bar, and throw away explicit relativistic effects. Take C to infinity, take lambda to zero, and keep only the acceleration of the universe. That's quasi-Newtonian, non-quantum mechanical domain of physical phenomenon coming from quantum gravity, delimited by an acceleration scale. Is there some physics there? And I want to suggest that there is physics there. That's a new domain of quantum gravitational phenomenon in the same sense that H bar and G going to zero, keeping the Planck energy fixed, is a new domain that relative locality explores. So let's explore that domain. What is the physics of this extreme infrared regime? And by the way, there's a lot of interest from quantum field theorists these days about extreme infrared physics. And this is an aspect of that interest for those who have been following the work of Strominger and others on that domain. So I'm going to suggest that there are two domains of correspondence from quantum gravity. The ordinary domain, which has to do with physics on scales small compared to the cosmological horizon, and therefore accelerations larger than the cosmological acceleration, so that the distance to the horizon your acceleration creates is a lot closer than the distance to the cosmological horizon. And this is the domain we understand. This is the domain dominated by the equivalence principle. This is the domain that recovers general relativity. But there's another domain, which is the one that I've just been talking about. Let's call it the cosmological constant dominated domain. There, the conditions of the equivalence principle, as usually stated, are violated because you're never smaller than the radius of curvature, because your minimal radius of curvature is given by the cosmological constant scale. What is the physics of the new domain, and could there in particular be a modification of the equivalence principle that holds in this new domain? And I'm going to suggest that there is. And I've just restated the question, but here's my proposal. My proposal is that the equivalence principle is weakened in a way that I'll explain later a little better, such as to relax the equality of inertial and gravitational mass so they can be proportional to some renormalization constant. The point is, in this domain, there's a lot of non-locality because the wavelength of your acceleration radiation is larger than the wavelength, than the size, than the distance to the horizon. So there's a lot of non-locality. And I'm going to suggest that non-locality can be coded in an influence on the ratio of the inertial and gravitational mass. So that becomes some function, not of the masses or those particles, but of the environment, in particular the temperature. And when you think what that could be a function of, it's a dimensionless function. It can be a function of the ratio of your unroot temperature to the de Sitter temperature, or equivalently a ratio of your acceleration to the cosmological acceleration, which remember, in the domain I'm talking about, is a number less than one, as is this. Or this is the regime in which the distance to your acceleration horizon is larger than the distance to the cosmological horizon.
I think you're confusing terminology here because, I mean, the acceleration is unroot, unroot temperature is non-gravitational acceleration. And for all celestial objects, that's zero because there is no external force acting on them.
Thanks for that comment. I will be proposing that we take this as the acceleration of the static observer in a static space-time classical or quantum, which is non-zero. It's not the acceleration of the elementary particle or the body whose motion we're following. In other words, there's some observer who has a frame of reference which is non-inertial and static, necessarily static in this domain and non-inertial in this domain. And that observer watches some local physics, and they have to correct the local physics by this renormalization factor. That's going to be my proposal. Let's come back to the end and see how friendly we are to each other. Okay, so this is the weakening of the equivalence principle that I'm proposing governs this domain. But now I've done all the setup, let's talk physics. We're interested in a domain of phenomena. We believe there is a small positive cosmological constant. It has an acceleration, which, by the way, is about 10 to the minus 8 centimeters per second squared. Where in the physical universe do we find a domain to use as a laboratory for the domain I'm calling the cosmological constant dominated domain of physics? Does anybody know? Is there, in fact, an experimentally accessible laboratory for accelerations on the order of or smaller than 10 to the minus 8 centimeters per second squared, which is the acceleration of the universe that, you know, that the newspapers and popular television are so interested in? Nobody knows? What? Outer regions of galaxies, yes. More than that, this is a typical acceleration for a star in a disk galaxy, is within two or so orders of magnitude of this acceleration. Let me stop there. That's a fact about astrophysics to be explained. That right there. I'm not going to explain it. whatever theory governs galaxy formation, whether it's cold dark matter or something else, has to explain. There is not a typical mass scale for galaxies. There's a large range of length scales for galaxies, but there is an acceleration scale for galaxies. Why is that? Why do galaxies form such as that's the case? I think that's a very interesting question we need to study. But it gives us a laboratory to study this domain of quantum gravity, if you've been following my assertion so far. So let's look at the phenomena. And now I'm going to repeat some of the things that Michaela said yesterday to talk about just a very rough introduction to the phenomenology of galaxy rotation curves. So this is a graph from a paper of Stacy McGough and collaborators from less than a year ago, about 6 months ago. And they did the following. They look at a sample of about 150 galaxies, disk galaxies of various kinds, from grand design, from galaxies like our own galaxy or Andromeda, to dwarf galaxies, diffuse galaxies, etc. And on each galaxy, they measure on the order of 10 data points. And at each data point, they compute two accelerations. One of them is looking at the redshift from the stars and using the acceleration is v squared over r, getting the size because they know the redshift of the whole galaxy. They compute the actual acceleration of stars at that point. And that's graphed on the vertical axis. That's 10 to the minus 10 meters per second squared, 10 to the minus 11 meters per second squared, et cetera. Then along the horizontal axis, they graph the predicted acceleration due to Newtonian dynamics that you get from adding up all the light, converting the light to a hypothesis about the distribution of stars, gas, and dust, and using Newtonian physics. And that's the horizontal acceleration. And this is the data over those 149 galaxies. It's on the order of 2,000 data points. And we notice there's a tight systematic relationship. For large acceleration, they're equal to each other. There's a critical acceleration at which they depart from equality. And then they follow a nice curve. And the point of this graph and this graph, which are technical, is that the error bars are explainable by experimental error, by observational error, not by scatter in the phenomenon. The curve that the data seems to be following when it departs from equality of these two accelerations, the observed acceleration goes like the square root of the predicted Newtonian acceleration times you have to put in an A0. An A0 is about 1.2 times 10 to the minus 8 centimeters per second squared. That is, it's within a factor of about 2 pi from the acceleration of the universe. Now, this is data. It may be explained by cold dark matter and the dynamics of galaxy formation and all those messy things having to do with baryons. Or it may be representing the discovery of a fundamental modification of dynamics. I think it's open. But notice that it's happening in this new domain that I'm calling a domain of quantum gravity. Okay, that's supposed to knock your socks off. And I think there's a lot of argument, there's a lot to say about it, but let me just mention it and go on. That's why I got interested in this subject again. I'll just speak for myself. That is, in the past, I've thought about this, I've abandoned it, it's too difficult. I've said to myself, it must be dark matter because the challenge of explaining this from quantum gravity, although tempting and seductive, is just too hard. There's too much non-locality to tackle. But when I saw this paper, I said, I got to go back and try to push this through a little bit. Just speaking for myself.
Two accelerations again. The two axes.
This is the observed acceleration, and this is the acceleration predicted from Newtonian dynamics, adding up the luminosity and interpreting in terms of. There's a whole technology of getting from the light of a galaxy what the mass luminosity relation should be, and all that is folded in.
It's directly inferred from the velocities.
It's directly inferred from the matter distribution. This, the vertical axis is inferred from the velocities. The horizontal axis is inferred from the luminosity. There are other surveys which have equivalent results. I think given the time, I'm not going to go into it. It's not my domain anyway. Here's another way to talk about the same physics called the Baryonic-Tully-Fisher relation. And that's an observation, first of all, that the rotation curves in the outer regions of the galaxy go to constants. They go to flat velocities, let's call it V, for a given disk galaxy. This is the observation made a long time ago that the luminosity of a galaxy, the total luminosity times a constant, scales with the velocity to a power, and the power is pretty close to 4. This is old data. I haven't updated this slide. Undoubtedly, I could have updated this slide since the first time I gave this talk. Which was a story I can tell that has to do with Vera Rubin, where I had the honor of debating about this in front of Vera Rubin in about 2004. Here's some old data which supports the claim that this is a pretty good relation. Then there's, as I said, a whole technology for defining the ratio k of luminosity to mass, where m is the baryonic mass, and you pull out of that that c times k times the baryonic mass is the fourth power of the velocity. It's easy to think that those two constants together should scale like Newton's constant, and what's left over is an acceleration scale A0. So this acceleration scale is read off the data, and it's the same acceleration as was in the data set I was telling you about before. It's 1.2 10 to the minus 8 centimeters per second squared. Okay, so this is another way to talk about the departure from Newtonian dynamics in the low acceleration regime. It's systematically governed in the limit of small acceleration, apparently by this Tully-Fisher relation. And again, there's some other data sets. Now, Milgram, I want to be clear about what I think Milgram did and Milgram didn't do, because I think he has a contribution, but it can be misstated. Milgram, in the early 80s, looking at this kind of data, made a conjecture for a phenomenological model. He said, for accelerations of stars and galaxies larger than this A0, I'm not going to touch dynamics. The acceleration is that given by Newton. And for accelerations smaller, the acceleration is the square root of the Newtonian one times this special acceleration A0. And he proposed that as a phenomenological model to talk about the data in disk galaxies. You can also invent fancier extrapolations between these two domains, and there's a whole literature you can read about that. I'm not going to need to mention it. Now, from the acceleration going like the square root of Newton's acceleration, that means it goes like r, but the acceleration goes like 1 over r. The acceleration goes like 1 over r, so you pull out of that immediately the Tully-Fisher relation and the fact that in the outer regions of galaxies, the velocity should become flat. Okay. What Milgram did not do is propose a theory of modified dynamics. He tried. There's a lot of interesting papers. a lot of interesting ideas, but in my view, he didn't succeed. What he did not do successfully, and neither did anybody else despite attempts, is propose a relativistic extension of this that's consistent. He didn't, therefore, this does not address lensing, clusters, large-scale structure. It is simply moot on those issues. It is a parameterization of data seen in galaxies. There, I think, to be taken seriously enough that whatever hypothesis you're developing, whether it's cold dark matter, axions, or you believe in some fundamental physics playing a role here, this is something to be explained. That's at least, that's what I would say is the sober view of it. Now, how well does this explain the details of galaxy rotation curves? And I think a fair assessment is that there in that domain, that simple phenomenological model is successful. There is a rotation curve. There's the radius in kiloparsecs. Of what radius is a star moving around. Here is a measure from luminosity of the stars and gas, their density. Here is the prediction from MOND using one free parameter, which is the luminosity to mass ratio of the galaxy, which in some of the recent literature is computed. But in the older literature is fit. So I think what I'm showing you is a case where the luminosity to mass ratio is fit. That's one parameter. Given that one parameter, A0 is a fixed constant off the Tully-Fisher relation, so you don't mess with that, but you can vary the light to mass ratio. So with that one parameter, here's a fit of the theory. The theory is that simple model I told you about to the data of the rotation curve. And I think you've got to be impressed by that. There's another one. There's dozens more. And Stacy McGill maintains some web pages where you can pull these things off the web. Again, this is not updated, but as of some years ago, there were 84 fits that they considered impressive, 11 fits that they considered problematic, which, of course, they tried to explain away. But this is just to argue that there's some teeth in this hypothesis. Again, maybe this is baryons and cold dark matter interacting in a very complicated way, like the weather. And maybe this is evidence for a fundamentally new domain of quantum gravity. But I hope I convince you, if I do nothing else, that this has to be taken seriously. Just to emphasize again, it has nothing to say about large-scale structure, lensing, relativistic extension, clusters. Okay, that's the data. Now, I think I have about 15 minutes. Which is not enough to say everything I plan to say, but I'll get to say most of it. Now I want to make the hypothesis connect the two things. In the first part of the talk, I hypothesize that there is a new domain, an unstudied domain of quantum gravitational phenomenon in the presence of a small positive cosmological constant, characterized by acceleration small compared to a certain scale. In the second part, I told you about some phenomenology dominated by a scale which is a factor of 5 or 6 from that scale. Now I want to connect them up and study the hypothesis that MOND is due to this new domain. That is, we have a laboratory for quantum gravity sitting up there in every disk galaxy to study. Just like in the case of relative locality, this is a domain, my hypothesis, and I'm very aware that this seems ridiculous. What the hell? Is he saying that quantum gravity is observable in the sky, in disk galaxies? Yes, that's what I'm proposing. What about H-bar? You're talking quantum gravity. There can be quantum phenomena from which H-bars cancel. What about relativity? There can be relativistic phenomena from which Cs cancel, leaving us in the quasi-Newtonian domain. That's what I suggest is happening. And now I'm going to develop this hypothesis until my time is up. Okay? I could stop here, I could go on a little bit. If you think it's been speculative up till now. Okay. So I said some things that were not exactly true about the undue effect and cosmological horizon and so forth, so I have to correct a little bit. So let's talk about acceleration and heat and their relation in the presence of a cosmological constant. A uniform, in the absence of a cosmological constant, this is just repeating things I said before, we've learned to associate a temperature with acceleration and a length scale with that temperature and acceleration, which is both the distance to the horizon of the observer that's accelerating and the peak wavelength of the corresponding thermal distribution. In the presence of a cosmological constant, this formula for the temperature that Unruh found gets modified to a formula discovered by Deser and Levin. And this is the correct formula, and I'm going to need to use it. So the Deser-Levin temperature is the square root of the sum of the squares of this de Sitter temperature I told you about, which is the ambient temperature of de Sitter spacetime, or the temperature of its horizon, and what the Unruh temperature would be of the accelerating body. And this means that... Sure.
So for this argument, do you need this quantity which you have calculated to be a temperature? Or is it okay if I just call it something else?
I don't know.
R, let me call it R for responsible movement detection.
Let's see. You'll see how I use it. I'm certainly open to that because it's... But here's an important thing to sketch in that formula. I paint a picture in which this length scale associated with the acceleration is going beyond the horizon. And that was not quite right. It piles up at the horizon. Here's where the associated wavelength goes as a function of the horizon scale and the acceleration length. And they pile up at the horizon. So what happens if you're an accelerated observer with small acceleration, smaller than the cosmological acceleration, is that the temperature that you experience has a peak wavelength which piles up at your cosmological horizon. This slide just reminds you of the hypothesis I made, which basically, the physical picture I have is that when you're computing whatever physics is behind the equality of gravitational and inertial mass, you're in a thermal bath with that Deser-Levin temperature. Because you're in a thermal bath, there's a renormalization of the ratio of inertial and gravitational mass. That's the hypothesis I'm making. Said now a little bit more precisely, these are the formulas for which I showed before. And just from dimensional analysis, this function, this renormalization function, has to be a function of the ratio of the acceleration of the detector to the cosmological acceleration, or the same thing with the temperatures. And maybe, Robert, all I need is this. So if you're happy talking in terms of the brute accelerations or the length scales, I don't need to talk about the temperatures. I said this before, but now is the time to say it. This is what I think survives of the equivalence principle in this domain. That a static detector in a static space-time experiences a temperature given by, I just said it doesn't have to be regarded as a temperature, but let me call it a temperature now, given by the Deser-Levin formula. So I'm considering that we are that static observer in an accelerated universe. We are, to keep our geometry, our local geometry, static, we have to accelerate. That gives us a physically defined acceleration, and there's a little heating up associated with that. Again, to remind you, this is just really a summary. There are two domains of acceleration in a quantum universe with a positive cosmological constant, which is small. The normal domain, which gets us back to general relativity, and the new equivalence, the new cosmological constant dominated domain, which I'm going to argue recovers Mond. Now, if I put together what I said, just look at the equation in the blue box. The usual Newtonian formula for the acceleration as a function of the gradient of the potential is modified by the ratio of the inertial and gravitational mass, which is usually 1, but now it's this renormalization factor z. So that's the entirety of the effect of quantum gravity, I'm proposing, in this domain, is this renormalization function z. Now, Milgram made a hypothesis about the physics that governs this renormalization z, which is that the dynamics in this domain of phenomena should be scale invariant. Great, okay, 10 minutes, thank you. We physicists love scale invariance. Scale invariance tells us we're in a critical domain, we're near a phase boundary, something critical is happening, something important is happening. So Milgram hypothesized that the dynamics in this new domain should be invariant under scaling the coordinates and the time by the same factor. I might remark that any homogeneous differential equation has such a scaling where the time scales by some power of the scaling of the spatial coordinates. Here, what has meat here is that power is 1, that they're scaling together. And that should make us feel happy because that reminds us of relativity. If the spatial coordinate and the time coordinate scale the same power, that could be consistent with relativity. In any case, if you impose that, that tells you what the renormalization factor z has to be. It has to be just the first power of whatever of the things it's a ratio of. And that gives you instantly, you plug it in, and it gives you that the acceleration magnitude squared is a Newtonian acceleration over the acceleration of the universe. And that gives us this characteristic relation, which I had expressed as A is like the square root of the Newtonian times the characteristic acceleration. So we recover the basics of the phenomenology that Milgram discovered. I don't claim that this is hand-waving. This is making an assumption to fit the data. I don't claim it's profound, but it's a story to be investigated. Okay, now, since I have 8 minutes, I'll tell you one more story about this. I said towards the very beginning that the best way to derive the Einstein equations from some fundamental hypothesis is through Jacobson's thermodynamic idea. The Einstein equations are an equation of state. Verlinde at some point, Eric Verlinde proposed a Newtonian version of that he called entropic gravity. And I regard, it's a beautiful little story, and I regard it as really the Newtonian limit of Ted Jacobson's story. And what I'm about to do, I could probably do at the level of Ted Jacobson's story, but I'm going to tell it to you at the level of Eric Verlinde's story. So what I'm going to do is tell you a version of Eric Verlinde's story of how the principle of inertia is a consequence of thermodynamics, of some more fundamental domain. And then I'm going to turn on the cosmological constant and tell you the story again. And then I'm going to stop. Well, I might, if I have time, sneak in one more little thing. Oh, and I should mention, I'm not the only person who's been down this road. There's a number of people who, of course, I stumbled down this road myself, but once I knew what the answer looked like, I went back to the literature and papers that I hadn't understood at all of a sudden spoke to me, and I realized that this had been done by other people. I don't know how many times that happens to you, that happens to me all the time. So here's the story. Imagine that we have some particle and we want to localize it within a detector. The detector has size L and the particle has some intrinsic size lambda C. Then if I locate it to within lambda C, I get some information, and the count of that information can be proportional to that ratio. So we can talk about an information measure due to localizing a particle, which goes like the size of the detector over the localization scale of the particle. And I throw the 2 pi in because I'll need it to get rid of some other 2 pi later. Okay. Now, supposing I extend the size of my detector in which I localize this particle. Then, from thermodynamics, if I'm doing this at a finite temperature, if there's an entropy which is being changed, because I'm changing the ratio of where the particle might be to where it's localized, so I'm changing the entropy, there's a force, an entropic force. You learn about these things in, you know, university thermodynamics. This is nothing profound. This is a force due to changing the size of a box where something is localized at a finite temperature. It looks like this. But let me assume that temperature, that the observer and the box are at some constant acceleration. So the temperature involved is the under temperature. Then that force is proportional to some constants times the acceleration. And those constants have an h bar divided by the size of the particle, divided by the speed of light. And if I call that whole thing the inertial mass, I get Newton's second law. The force is the inertial mass times the acceleration. Now that's cute. It may be right, it may be deep, but it's cute. Okay, will you give me that? And notice that if you think the constant wavelength is a quantum phenomenon, my h-bar is canceled, getting to an effect we think of as characteristic of Newtonian physics, when it's really a quantum effect. And the speeds of lights were there and canceled, giving us Newton's laws, but really from a relativistic physics. Okay. So turn on the cosmological constant, and then I have to think of the Desert-Levine temperature. But then if I go back to the force law, the entropic force law, I shouldn't use the total temperature, I should use the increase of temperature over the de Sitter temperature. Why? Because if I'm sitting at the de Sitter temperature, the temperature is isotropic, there's no acceleration. So I have to normalize my formula for the entropic force by subtracting off the ambient temperature. So I propose this formula for the entropic force. And lo and behold, the difference between the two of them, when expressed in terms of accelerations, is quadratic in the acceleration, divided by the acceleration of the universe. So you get the force proportional to the square of the acceleration. And that's the phenomenology that Mond claims. So it's a pretty little story about where that might come from. If you think that the origin of inertia, the origin of general relativity, and the origin of Newton's laws is thermodynamic. It's a cute story. I wouldn't go on too much about this. It's just an indication that it might be worth it to do the considerably more work and work this all out at the general relativistic level using an extension of Jacobson's argument. Or at least to look in the literature and see whether somebody's done that already. Okay, I think this just summarizes what I already said. Okay, I have one more thing to say, and I'll say it in a minute. Everything I've said, if you want to think, how does this extend to a description of general relativity, you can use the language of biometric theories to extend. And I'll just show you the slide. What you should do I scale the RR component of the metric by the renormalization factor. And now you're hypothesizing that the Einstein equations govern the gravitational field in terms of the metric, but the geodesic principle for the motion of a particle in free fall uses a rescaled metric. And then you can describe, you're not explaining anything, but you're giving an alternative description in the language of bimetric theories, say in general relativity. And when you do that, this will be my last slide. There's one more phenomenon. There's a correction to your radial acceleration. So if there are stars in galaxies in the cosmological constant regime moving radially rather than circularly, there should be a new effect. And that's something that astronomers could look for, or perhaps again is already in the literature. Okay, very good. Well, thank you very much. That's the summary.